Greetings, movie lovers. Welcome to the Midnight Cinema, where the souls of dead films still flit about in the flickering shadows. I am your host, the Ghost of Cinema Past, and I'm here to talk about movie magic, about lost dreams and lost wonder. Movies you may never have heard of. Movies from the first century of the art. Movies which may not be the greatest films ever made, but which deserve to be remembered nonetheless, and to find a new audience among the living. I presume that includes you, but you never know, do you? Tonight, I'm going to summon up three celluloid spirits, plus a cartoon and a cereal, just like the old days. Stick around. Who knows? You may be joining us someday soon. Our first film tonight is They Might Be Giants from 1971. It stars George C. Scott as Justin Playfair, a New York judge whose mind has withdrawn into fantasy following his wife's death. He now believes himself to be the great fictional detective Sherlock Holmes. His own brother, who's being blackmailed by gangsters and needs the ready cash, tries to have him declared incompetent. The interview with the doctor, played by Joanne Woodward, does not go well.
Girl scout killed crossing street. Grandmother raped and beaten. Orphanage in flames, five die. Excursion boat explodes. Who does these things? Who is responsible?
Well, there might be accidents.
I don't believe in accidents. Take Mr. Small, for instance. How did I bring that off? Because there are two laws in life. All things are logical. They must make sense. And no things are ever exactly what they seem. Each accident is part of a design. And every object has its secret side.
Is that how you did it?
Is it so insane?
Why didn't you use that word?
Yes, but you think it. That's what brought you here.
No, I came here because your brother... You do have a brother, don't you?
Blevins, yes, of course.
You've remembered something from your past.
I know all about my past. And Blevins isn't in it. He's not in the speckled band or... Check it out. I've been completely written up. Still, if he needs to think we're brothers, let him use me. I can answer when he calls me Justin. After all, it's only a name.
Do many people call you Holmes?
No, scarcely anyone.
That must make you very much alone.
It does that, but it doesn't make me wrong. I've listened to so many doctors tell me who I am. I've studied Justin Playfair. I've read all his books, his papers, his decisions, everything he did. He tried to make the world the kind of place it might have been. It drove him mad. He lost his mind. But I am not that man.
I'd like to come and visit you from time to time.
What for? I don't need doctoring.
Mr. Holmes.
Don't call me that. You don't believe I'm Holmes. I won't be patronized.
You don't have to snap at me.
A lunatic is entitled to his temper. Go away.
I want to help you.
$20,000, some of the money, everybody else.
I'm on your side.
Nobody's on my side.
Oh. The whole world is against you. Typical. Now, when did this sense of persecution start?
When you walked in.
If you're not careful, I'm going to walk right out.
Woman, I have got to think. My life depends on what I think.
Your life depends on me.
Well, God help me then.
Put down that ridiculous violin.
Holmes fiddles, honey, think.
That's awful.
Cannot, I absolutely cannot play the goddamn thing. Stop laughing at me.
I'm not laughing.
I'll show you. That paper is real. Moriarty is real. I am not mad. You want to test me out? Let's test me out on you.
Very well.
You'll tell me when I'm wrong.
I'll shake when wrong and nod when right, like Mr. Small.
Are you ready?
Go right ahead.
You're left-handed. Your molars and incisors, lower right, are false. You tint your hair and have a vitamin deficiency. You were a tomboy and an only child. Your adolescence was a nightmare, and you didn't lose your acne until your middle 20s. You can neither cook nor sew, and your apartment needs a thorough cleaning. You suffer from insomnia and sometimes drink yourself to sleep. You think you're homely and you're glad you're growing old. You bite your nails. You're frightened you're a failure, but you're lost without your work. I've got more. Do you want it?
By all means.
You haven't any friends. You have never been engaged. No one you've loved has ever loved you back. You're stubborn and inflexible. You've got a temper that you can't control. That suit is 10 years old, and you annoy the living Jesus out of me.
Scott's terrible British accent actually works to his benefit here, since he's not playing Sherlock Holmes, but a man in retreat from reality. When it develops that the doctor's name is Mildred Watson, that retreat becomes a headlong flight, not only from reality, but from the police department and the mob.
I didn't write that.
Someone did.
My brother.
Oh, that's just great. He knows. This nut knows all about me.
He'll be in a cell. What can you do?
You get his money if he dies, right? Where's he at?
He's disappeared.
All right, here's how it is. You find him first, it's the loony bin for life. I find him first. And...
later, following an incident on Broadway, Playfair and Watson start to come to terms.
You came through very nicely back there. I'd like to thank you for defending me.
I didn't defend you. I attacked them. There's a difference.
All the same.
Now, I wish you'd stop thanking me for everything I do.
You're rather touchy one, aren't you? You don't want anyone to owe you anything.
Perhaps you ought to be the analyst.
I am only a gifted amateur. Here. What do you make of it?
God, you're just like Don Quixote. You think everything is always something else.
Well, he had a point. Of course, he carried it a bit too far, that's all. He thought that every windmill was a giant. That's insane. But thinking that they might be, well, all the best minds used to think the world was flat. What if it isn't? It might be round. And bread mold might be medicine. And if we never looked at things and thought of what they might be, why, we'd all still be out there in the tall grass with the apes.
Look, are we cruising and taking in the sights or what?
6th Avenue and 10th, and if you want a nickel tip, keep talking.
They Might Be Giants is one of our favorite movies here in the Midnight Cinema for its wholehearted embrace of all people eccentric and odd, for its charm and unlikely romance, for the lovely performances from a top-flight cast, and for its very daring ending, which shows nothing less than the triumph of imagination over reality. We're not saying that it's a great or even a necessarily well-made movie, but we love it unreservedly. Our next film was never released to movie theaters, but made for British television. We're not elitists here in the Midnight Cinema. Any film we admire is welcome on our silver screen. She Fell Among Thieves, from 1978, features Malcolm McDowell, cast well against type, as Richard Chandos, stalwart hero of the Edwardian age. This gothic adventure story is just the type of thing that our close friend Mr. Edward Gorey so wholeheartedly embraced in his illustrated books. The script was freely adapted by comic novelist Tom Sharp from a book by Darnford Yates. The story opens at a wedding of questionable legality where the bride and groom are both unwilling participants.
Thank you.
McDowell becomes involved in the affair quite by accident when a body washes downstream right through his pleasant fishing expedition. A Scotland Yard detective, played by Michael Jaston, reveals to Shandos that the body belonged to a former associate of the international malefactor and all-around bad person, Vanity Fair, who has been secluding herself out of his reach in her nearby castle. He suggests a ruse whereby Shandos can be introduced into Vanity Fair's inner circle. Shandos agrees, but while engaging in some verbal fencing around the dinner table, he comes to realize that the guests in Vanity Fair's castle are also prisoners in her sinister web.
What do you do?
Do?
When you aren't parking your Rolls on the wrong side of the road.
Well, actually, I manage my uncle's estate.
And drive a Rolls? My, how things have changed. When I was a girl...
Rolls were not invented.
Nor was the baronetcy of Rochelle come to that. The Baron's a sportsman, or so he'd have us believe.
Shooting singing birds is hardly my idea of sport. I understand you fish.
Yes, I thought I might try the river.
You might try the fish, but I fancy you'd find them wanting. Gaston will use dynamite.
When I was up at Oxford...
Oxford. That was before you took the cloth.
My father was a Balliol man.
Balliol man? I seem to remember a Shandos.
I've always liked that up at Oxford. It suggests that everything afterwards is down.
True, madame. And the truth in my case,
if memory serves me rightly, there was no case. Not so with you, eh, Acorn?
Let the dead past bury.
The dead, how apt. And now Mr. Shandos must sing.
Sing, madame?
For your supper. You've told us so little about yourself.
There's little enough to tell.
Then you must invent it.
I fancy you would see through any invention, madame.
Oh! A pretty turn of speech at last. Did you know that one of your ancestors was king of the Cotswolds and that another was a patron of the poet Pope?
I see you keep yourself remarkably well informed.
I find it pays in the long run. And which Shandos are you? The one that Pope complimented, "Thus gracious Shandos is beloved at sight"? Or was Swift right with, "A great complier with every court"? There's no need to twitch, Acorn. There are other courts than those of law. Besides, Mr. Shandos hasn't answered.
I would prefer an earlier age than Pope's, madame. Sir John Shandos fought at Crecy and Poitiers, where he saved the Black Prince's life.
And so he did. And do you see yourself as a gallant knight?
I see myself as a simple man, and that's the truth.
Why? So I think you do. And how do you see me?
As one born out of time, madame.
You never spoke a truer word. Have I said something vulgar?
I was just thinking.
I wonder what that grinding noise was. I thought you were masticating a fork. We'll have to see that the wedding gifts include an adequate supply. And now you must excuse us, Mr. Shandos. The ladies don't withdraw at Jezreel. We all keep early hours.
Vanity Fair is played by the magnificent Eileen Atkins, whose apparent sense of humor never spills over the top, but rises right to the edge of the glass. She Fell Among Thieves is not a classic, but a perfect little sinister confection laced with poison. We recommend it to all who smile ever so slightly at all things dark or grim. For our last feature tonight, we travel from the mountainous border of France to the sunny beaches on its coast. Although Monsieur Hulot's Holiday is a sound film made in 1953, it highlights a return to the styles and substance of silent era comedy plotless, almost devoid of meaningful dialogue, but full of expressive characters, collisions, attractions, and conflicting ideas on what it means to be at leisure, the film follows the adventures of a solitary man making an attempt to be social, perhaps for the first time in his life.
D'une façon catégorique du progressisme, d'accord, mais avec prudence. Voilà le mot d'ordre, indicatif catégorique.
I was in the same sector that the English army, Thomas. At that époque, I was officier. You know, les Ardennes. Very dangerous sector. You remember, n'est-ce pas? I received orders from le général, un bon ami à moi. Je prends la tête pour accomplir une mission délicate. I don't know si vous vous rappelez des Ardennes en temps de guerre, but croyez-moi, my dear friend, on ne s'y promène pas aussi facilement que sur les Champs-Élysées.
Hulot, played by director Jacques Tati, is both a tribute to the great silent clowns and a lovable clown in his own right. Subtle and delightful, as good as a real vacation, Monsieur Hulot's Holiday is a film to revisit many times in season and to be remembered as you would a happy journey from your childhood in a land you can never reach again. In the golden age of cinema, audiences never sat down to just a movie, but were treated to a full menu of appetizers before and after the feature. There were newsreels, musical novelties, comedy shorts and cartoons, and often a serial. These breakneck-paced morsels of suspense, action, and cliffhangers were the direct inspiration for the fantasy franchises of today. Week after week, they brought audiences back to the theater to see how the heroes and heroines escaped from the diabolical death traps the villains had placed them in. Daredevils of the Red Circle from 1939 is an excellent example of the great Republic serials of the period. It features Flash Gordon's original Ming the Merciless Hatchet faced Charles Middleton as the villain known by his prison ID 39013, whose only goal in life is to destroy the business holdings of the man who put him behind bars.
The score is a long way from being evened yet, Doctor. When I get through with Horace Grandel, he'll be entirely ruined. Read me the list of the Grandel properties remaining.
There's the Granville Amusement Center. It represents quite a lot of money.
Amusement Center, eh? That's it. It'll be next.
What happened?
I don't know, but it's a cinch we can't get down the ladder.
We both have to slide.
Get going!
As Chapter 1 draws to a close, High Diver Jean, played by Charles Quigley, races ahead of the raging torrent that 39013's team of offshore drillers has caused to flood a newly opened underground tunnel. Escape, it'll cost you another 10 cents to find out when you come back for the next thrilling episode playing in next week's matinee at your hometown theater. The last item on our menu is Dizzy Red Riding Hood from 1931. From the earliest days of animation, cartoons played on most movie programs and were not intended as children's entertainment, but something the whole audience could enjoy on different levels. The double entendre is a vanishing breed of comedy, driven out in the wholesale war on pop culture that began at the end of the last century. Nobody embraced the double entendre more enthusiastically than Max and Dave Fleischer, who not only invented the rotoscope process, but produced cartoons with an earthy sense of humor, specifically designed to appeal to both children and grown-ups. Betty Boop was his biggest character, until the Hayes office reined in her sexuality, starting in 1934. Dizzy Red Riding Hood is very naughty indeed, depending on how you approach it. The complete cartoon is coming up. We hope you get a charge out of it. But before I fade away, if you've enjoyed this little program, please like the video and subscribe to the channel. It costs you nothing and lets us know that you'd like to see more manifestations like this in the future. So long. And I hope to see you again when next I appear in the Midnight Cinema. Remember, it is later than you think. Soon, we will all be ghosts.
Listen, my children, and you shall hear an exciting story of a little deer. There's been read rumors of Riding Hood. Some are bad and some are good. Why do they pick on the poor little kid? Some say she didn't and some say she did. You surely heard the story before, that she tried to keep the wolf from the door. How really true can the story be? Well, watch, my dears, and you will hear and see.
A little fish for Grandma.
Fish cakes for Grandma.
May I go along with you?
My mother wouldn't want me to. Oh.
Beware, beware, there's a wolf in there.
Oh, 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 oh. How do you do? Beware, beware, there's a wolf in there.
I swear, I do declare.
Oh, 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 oh. Oh, oh. La 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 la
some flowers.
Oh.
Break the news to Granny. I'll eat you for baloney. Tell her not to wait for you, for you're not coming home. Fairies like them too. Grandma's gone to the fireman's ball.
Come in.
Mm-hmm.
those eyes? Where'd you get those lips? Where'd you get those big ears, Granny? They make you look so big and manly. Those chins, those nose, your big fat head. I'm scared. Oh, I'm afraid. Your eyes look red. How'd your arms get long? And so big and strong. How'd you get those black hairs on them? And the muscles all around them. Oh, dear old Grandma, what teeth you have.
The better to eat you.
That's all there is, children. Goodbye.
Soup's on.